100%, but only the last 25%. There are rotary heat exchanges or plate heat exchanges. I will show them some pictures later on. But this is the third point, main point in introduction of passports. If we're using ventilation units, it's important to get this building tight to make the ventilation more efficient, not to lose the energy through holes or some leakage everywhere. And that means in passive buildings or energy efficient buildings, we are doing a measurement of all door tests for airtightness. And if this value is too high, we have to optimize our envelope and make it more tight. The last one is, the last point, are the heat bridges. Heat bridges, everybody's heard about it already. Heat bridges, sometimes they're cleared, for example, like this balcony connection through our warm envelope, our insulation envelope. Sometimes we cannot solve them, because sometimes there are foundations or walls going through our basement insulation. These are heat bridges we have to calculate. Sometimes it's possible to clear them, sometimes it's only possible to reduce them. We have to live with this. But the one, or for me, most important point to achieve passive house quality is the energy balance. It's not enough to choose good windows, a little bit more insulation than the neighbor, ventilation units from the catalyst. You don't know if it's a passive house or not. And you have to do this energy balance. Already two-dimensional or three-dimensional energy balancing, and what is considered in this energy balancing? We have loses and gains, and these loses are from the ventilation unit, because we have fresh cold air, that means we need energy, and that means ventilation is loose. We are losing energy for our areas, for our wall, for our windows or roof. We have loses through our tightness, this is inside here. And on the other side, we have gains. We heard already solar gains, depends on which direction our glazings are. We heard salt is great, but take care, salt is great, a bomb, later. If you're building below, it's changed. And you have these tools, there are Excel files, like for example this PHPP from Passive Institute we can use, or there is a tool for the PHPP based on SketchUp. We can draw a simple model and get first values quite fast. I think there is a course up some this week or next week for Design PH, for example, to get a feeling. And it's nice for architects, you're sketching your design and put during windows and the basic information, and you will get the result for heating, cooling. Then you can change the windows or the rotation and see the results. It's going very fast. All right, that means these 5 points and the energy balance are the magic. When it's done wrong, we can see it. We can photograph it. We can see the heat bridges. And to avoid this, we would make the same points again, but with some numbers. And thermal envelope. Thermal envelope, we heard already about the U values. When you're talking about passive house in more cold climate zones, the U value should be around 0.1 or 0.15 watt per square meter Kelvin. How many of you have already calculated your values? All right. That's good. The second thing, heat bridges. Heat bridges, we can calculate heat bridges. I will show some examples later on. But they are always the same. Every building has corners. Every building has connections to the ground. You have to mark them and to look at the details. Is it possible to optimize this? Make a fast two-dimensional calculation calculate the C value. This is for hill bridges. And if it's below 0.01 and what per meter Kelvin, and then it's fine. We heard about glazing. The G value is important, how much energy the window will pass through. The U value of the window in passive loss quality is about 0.8. And if we start to compare these U values, for example, you know, we heard in the passive loss and wall should be around 0.1. That's a U value of 0.1. The window is 0.8. It's 8 times worse. And this is already a good window. You know, if you see buildings with 100% glazing, and somebody is saying this is a passive house, 90%, it's hard to believe it. Because with a whole building envelope with 0.8, you will never achieve this low energy demand. That means this U value is a nice indicator for is it possible or what I'm doing here. Alright, and the air tightness is measured in N50 value, should be in passive houses below 0.6. In Austria it's by low 1, the value 1 if you're using ventilation units, to make the ventilation units more efficient. And the ventilation units, you can use someone, you have to optimize it or measure it. The heat recovery should be higher than 75%, and the energy demand should be not too high. If you achieve all this quality criteria, you will get the results for your building, for heating, cooling, heating load, cooling load. Air tightness, the value is get measured. If you achieve values below this criteria, you will get this certified passive house certificate. Yeah, this one, that's simple. Passive House Institute in Darmstadt is in charge for the whole world. Every passive house in the world which has got certified got this certification from there. Alright, these are the basic principles of passive house. Now we will go a little bit more in detail to the differences like regular building and passive house. And in passive house, we have the highest comfort you can achieve in buildings with the ventilation unit. And the second thing I will talk about is surface temperatures. On the left, a regular building from inside, a room, living room, with a balcony window. The surface temperatures are marked. Outside is minus 10, inside the air, having both rooms 22 degrees. On the right side, a passive house building, on the left side, a regular building. And in both rooms, 22 degrees air temperature. But the surface temperature of the outside walls is different, because in this building we don't have as much insulation, and that's why the surface temperature is lower. And this is a huge difference. If your window, for example, at minus 10 outside, 10 degrees inside, window surface, you will feel it. Our body is very sensitive, we are feeling 2 degrees difference already. And the difference between 10 and 22 is very huge. I'm always saying on this point, you know, it's a difference if you stand up on Sunday and you look outside with your coffee in your hand and leaning on your glass in the passive house and you don't get cold in winter. In a regular building, you wouldn't make this. You will stay 1 meter away from your glazing because you know it's getting colder every day. And it's a different usage of passive houses. Nobody's saying this about it. Always they're saying, oh, my passive house needs a lot of insulation. I'm losing area which I can sell. But you use it different. Don't forget it. And you have different comfort. We're talking about comfort. This is, you know, Apple and Python. Hard to compare. Because always your questions are it's expensive. Yes, but you will get something completely different. And this is working in all climate zones. Passive House Institute have recommendations for climate zones and where and how to optimize the passive house in which direction, where to start. All right, how to heat it. One of our topics is building services, and I will try to make the jump to heating. You know, and we will talk about this warm envelope. And in this case, we have one warm envelope. It's perfect. We are not losing a lot of energy, but we still need heating or cooling energy. How to make this in the past? To answer this, we have to think about heat. Heat, how is heat working? You know, heat transfer, which kinds of heat transfer are there? Heat is always going from the warm to the cold side. It's quite easy. And our goal is to interrupt this. The simplest picture to this is compare for a coffee machine, which is heating for all time to keep the temperature of my coffee. And on the right side, there is a can of insulation with no electric connection. It's keeping the temperature as well. Not that long with this one. But this is a nice compare to a passive house idea with a good envelope and a building which has a worse envelope. Here I'm losing a lot of energy. Here I'm saving the energy inside where I need it. That means, compared to our building, we're trying to reduce to make this envelope and to reduce our connections. Yeah. Some pictures from thermal cameras where you can see bad points. We try to optimize them. Sometimes it's already too late when we have these pictures. The heat transfer. There are some kinds of heat transfer. We are interested in heat transfer through walls, through our details. And when we're talking about areas, we heard already there is U value, one of the numbers we're interested in. To calculate the U value, we need the lambda value of the materials we're using. I don't know if you know already some lambda values, but for example, when we keep concrete in a thickness of 20 centimeters, we will get a heat loss of 230. Concrete has a lambda of 2.3 watts per meter Kelvin. If we take 20 centimeters of rock wool with a lambda of 0.04, which is regular insulation, the heat loss is in a difference here. That means this number of the material is very important. And if you choose a material, or if I, as in physics, am choosing a material, that's one of the first things I'm looking for. In China, there are a lot of companies, and sometimes they don't have data sheets. And they're saying, all right, my product is very good. What means very good? I have to calculate it. I have to choose something. All right, but I'm responsible for the results. And
why is the heat loss with concrete so much higher in comparison to mineral?
The heat loss?
Yeah.
The thermal conductivity, concrete is letting heat faster through, is higher. This is the lambda value. And with the lambda value and the thickness, I could calculate my U value. I will show the formula. We have seen it already, but I will show it in a few slides. U value, I can calculate the heat loss. But the next slide will explain it. Lambda values. You know, I need this formulas very often. I printed out in my office, and my colleagues have it as well. Things changing, and you not remembering always all numbers, but you should have a feeling. What is insulation? What is good insulation? What is a thermal breaking material? What not? And here's the formula for heat loss. When we transition heat loss, is the area I want to calculate by the U value. We know the U value is the mixture from thickness and lambda value. And my data for heating degree hours. Get this from my climate data. And that's how heat loss is calculated. You know, you have wall areas,
already calculate your heat loss by this areas, by the ground. It's pretty easy. And that's nice on energy balancing. There are very easy methods to got results. It's not 100% accurate. Three-dimensional energy balancing is more accurate than two-dimensional. But for example, with the PHPP calculation from Passive House Institute, it's proved with thousands of passive houses calculated and monitored that it's accurate, that it fits up to 5%. All right, when we are taking an example, we have 1 square meter of our wall. We will have a U value, and this is a correction factor. We will use it in the PHPP sometimes, sometimes not, if we don't know it, and the climate data. And this is how much energy we will need over a year. And when we multiply this with the area, it's that easy. All right, more in detail. Somebody wants to calculate it, or I think tomorrow afternoon, today afternoon, you will calculate some kind of exercises. But it's looking more maybe a little complicated, but it's quite simple. It's always thickness, lambda value, and in the beginning and the end is inside and outside factors. That's how we calculate the U values. Second thing, yeah. A lot of more. I try to break it down to give you an overview of what we are doing here with energy balancing.
It changes if the climate is opposite, if it's hot outside and inside is cold.
Very good question. For example, I have a project in South China where it's humid and hot. And the image of passive house in South China or in hot climates, passive house is working in Europe fine, but not here. And we are proving now with the monitoring that it's working. It's not changing completely, but for example, in insulation, when you're talking about insulation and walls, you can reduce it a lot. But you will still need the protection in summer for getting too hot. But in winter, you could reduce it. If you don't have the summer, you could reduce it in winter. But it's not turning somehow very huge. All right. When we could calculate the heat loss through walls, that's easy. For example, we have a wall with 40 centimeters thickness and a wall with 20 centimeter thickness. There is a change. I don't know, architects have an idea and it looks like this. We learned we can calculate our heat loss through this part, you know, like this, and calculate our heat loss to this part. It would be easy if this works. But every change in the structure, and when we are calculating this with a two-dimensional software, the result is different than our calculation. And we are looking on the isotherms, these lines are showing the direction of the heat. They are not parallel anymore. There is something changing. And when isotherms are not going parallel anymore, we are talking about heat bridges. Already a change in the thickness of the wall is a heat bridge. When we are calculated by the software, there is a difference between the two-dimensional calculation and our software result. And if this is higher than 0.01, we have to optimize this point. It's that easy. I just wanted to show that not only connections from balconies or something like this are heating bridges, but these geometrical heating bridges are as well important. For example, corners is a change, and depends which measurement you're calculating, and you will get different results. Or connection between roof and wall. This is a heating switch. Sometimes the result is below zero. What does this mean? Our construction is producing energy? No. And this is a kind of mathematical problem we have with heat bridges, because when you transfer, for example, we have this wall, and the length of this wall compares to the length of our insulation outside. When we are calculating this corner, we have this length compared to much more insulation. If we calculate this, we'll get a minus. But it would be wrong in my energy balance calculate only these heat bridges to reduce my demand, because this is not real. My building is not producing energy. Let's do some difference. Balcony plates. We're using a lot of energy through concrete balcony plates. It's common that there are products already which are conductivity breakers. You can install them. It's not that expensive, and you will solve this problem. Or we have heat bridges with the connection to the ground. Basement, insulation ends here, for example, and this is our warm room. And it's important the surface temperature, probably, because when the surface is too cold, we will get concentrated. Water will collect on the spines, and the weakest spines in buildings are always corners, and all most is something in front of these corners, that the air cannot circulate very well, and humidity is the result, and it looks like this. And this is something we want. We have the possibility to destroy these problems. Why not? And if you take care for heat bridges, you will solve this. This is not an issue in acidosis. Should not. Okay, but how to start? When you get the project, how to start? If I have my plans, my drawings, I will take two colors. And first, I have to think about my warm envelope, my insulation envelope. And I will point the pen on one circle and try to go around without stopping and taking it away. That means everywhere where I'm cutting a wall or a connection, I should mark it, because there is a heat bridge. I have to look closer up. That means first is my warm envelope and all the leaky points where I have to look for. And the second thing is the air tightness. Why do I have to do this